published last week our autumn forecast, and we are going to have an important package of, let's say, some surveillance documents being published actually tomorrow by the Commission, being finalized as we speak. So it falls, let's say, nicely in between two, let's say, institutional appointments. Now, so this is the this is the topic. So optimal, okay. Economists talk about optimal policy mix. I was I have been tempted to do it as well. I think let's look at it in terms of better policy mix than the optimal ones. If we would get to a better one, I think it would really be an improvement. First one is towards a more balanced policy mix. The second, I mean, no, I'm going to talk very little for because of institutional, let's say, responsibility on monetary policy, but I'll look at fiscal policy and I'll look at structural reforms. Basically, when now we talk about policy mix, is not only the macro one, so fiscal, monetary, but there is also the structural reforms element which comes in, and this is before concluding. Okay, on the, Debbie mentioned, I mean, the G20, my role in the G20, I think the relevant starting point is, you know, what the G20, being in charge of global governance, has indicated as, you know, the direction for the policy mix for G20 countries. And here I've reproduced a paragraph from the G20 leaders' communique of the summit in Hangzhou, so beginning of September. This has been with the G20, this orientation for, I think, for about a year, but it has been, let's say, codified and adopted by leaders in under the Chinese presidency. So basically what it indicates here that we need a coordinated set of policies, and this is the commitment. We are determined to use all policy tools, monetary, fiscal, and structural, individually and collectively, to achieve our goal of strong, sustainable balance and inclusive growth. I note in passing that the G20 was in favor and has a final aim until Hangzhou to have to achieve strong, sustainable, and balanced growth, and the issue of inclusiveness has been added lately. So this element here, inclusiveness, which pertains to the issue of fairness, participate in the gain of globalization, etc., has become clearly a relevant dimension of the G20 policy lately. And, you know, if you go back to the events of the past week, in the US, this element here clearly is playing a role, and it has moved up to the direct political level. So monetary policy will continue to support economic activity, ensure stability consistent with central bank mandate, but monetary policy cannot lead alone to balanced growth. So there is a call to use in a more proactive way the other two set of tools, i.e. fiscal policy and structural policy. So this is the consensus at the level of the G20. Now, how do we translate this? Now, monetary policy, fiscal policy, and structural reforms. So if one looks at the translation of this in terms of the euro area, you come to this, which is, let's say, an inconsistent triangle. So here you can achieve the other two, but it's very difficult to achieve the three together. So what do we have now? And the three poles here, basically, they are connected somehow to the three prong of the strategy that I mentioned before. So it is very difficult within the Eurozone to achieve what you have here at the bottom, namely sustainability of debt burdens, private and public, and competitiveness gains in more vulnerable economies, so those who have to regain competitiveness after the crisis, and do that in an environment of inflation persistently below target. It is easy to understand because if you have, like now, at the euro area level, you know, basically zero or slightly positive, but you know, very, very low inflation, then if you want to gain competitiveness within by some countries within the Eurozone, then you have to have an inflation below the average. But if the average inflation is zero, then you have to have a negative inflation. And the negative inflation, you know, you can gain competitiveness. That is very difficult, but you can do that. But clearly that runs into conflict with the sustainability of high debt burdens, because via the denominator, the public debt and private debt go up. So basically what we'll need to have is to have to go back to normal level of inflations, which are defined by the ECB as inflation rate around 2% or slightly below 2%. And with that, you can then achieve more easily the other two objectives. But the message of the G20 is that you cannot leave only to the ECB the relaunch of inflation, relaunch of growth. You need to use all the policies for that purpose. Now, this is comes from the autumn forecast published last week. Basically, what do you see here? You have since the beginning of the crisis, so 2008. You have a growth rate of GDP and the cumulative change in the level of GDP. So what you see here is that we have gone back, let's say, to moderate growth, and in our forecast this should continue around 1.5% in the year 2017 and 2018. After, you know, a period of subdued growth, and that you can see it in the level of GDP. The level of GDP has, for the euro area as a whole, has gone back to the pre-crisis level. So that's where the lighter line here crosses the horizontal axis. Only in 2015, so it has taken 7 to 8 years. To go back where we were before the crisis. I mean, for the US, it took about between 2 and 3 years. So it has taken a long time. Clearly, and within the euro area, you have a differentiated performance. You have countries like Germany and France who went back to the level of 2008 in between 2011-2012. Ireland, it has gone back to the level of 2014. And you have other countries like Italy and Spain who have not gone back yet to the pre-crisis level. So this is a picture which is a pretty discomforting one because the legacy of the crisis is still clearly with us. There is a substantial economic slack remaining in the economy. You see indicators here. You have employment still, you know, going up slowly, but still remaining, below 2008 level. A measure of slack in the labor market is also the total hours worked. So it means here there is, more part-time and more temporary work. Which have slided down and are coming up gently, but we are still well below the level of 2008. And if you take here, in the previous slide I showed you the GDP. Here I take domestic demand. So you can see for domestic demand for the euro area as a whole, this is the domestic demand is the red one. In 2016, we are still not at the level of the pre-crisis. So it means that we have relied a lot on external demand to pull up Europe, and much less by the, let's call it, the indigenous strength of growth sources. Now, as I talk, think about Trump and what has been said in the US, and I think the assessment of the desirable policy mix looking forward will have to rely to, I mean, to push us to rely much more on domestic demand in Europe rather than relying on the rest of the world to pull up Europe, because I think with the evolution in the US and with the evolution in China, we may have lost, let's say, the consumer last resort in the US and the investor last resort in the global economy in China. So we have to rely much more on what we can do ourselves. So the policy mix that we are thinking about will have to be more favorable to domestic demand. Now, what you can see here also is I have put in this graph, which is less usual than the previous ones, the current account on the horizontal axis and inflation on the vertical axis. And you can see the two lines where they cross. Is on the inflation, I put the horizontal line at 2%. That is broadly the objective of the ECB. So if you are there at 2%, that's the definition of price stability. On the vertical axis here on the current account is, let's say, a slight surplus in the current account. This is much less official number, and our estimates, DG ECFIN Commission estimates, of the equilibrium current account of the euro area, taken into, calculated through our models, taking into account demographic variables in industry structure and other, fundamental variables. So there is a good reason to have a slight current account surplus for the euro area as a whole. I mean, we are becoming older, so we save more than other countries. So you have for the euro area at large, I think, a good reasons to have, a slight surplus on the current account. Now, where do we stand here on these two measures? Well, you can see that since 2013, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, so these includes the our autumn forecast, we are in the quadrant there where you have a much larger current account surplus than would be justified by fundamentals, and you have a lower inflation. So this would plead for using policies in order to push domestic demand, in order to shore up inflation and to reduce our current account surplus. In a situation in which you have in the global governance, the orientation that I mentioned before, I don't think we can, we can continue this large current account surplus to pull up the economy. So this is an illustration of what of the message that I passed before. So, and these, the two elements here, they are also indications that there is, substantial slack in the economy. We have domestic demand lower than, savings considerably larger than investment, and inflation below this is the definition of price stability of the ECB. Now, finding the right policy mix, that's where this graph here captures, the two axes, so monetary policy and fiscal policy. And what you can see here is that we are moving to the left, which is a situation in which monetary policy has been increasingly accommodative, but fiscal policy has had has been in the consolidation phase 2011, 12, 13, strong consolidation overall. This was the moment of the crisis of the of the sovereign debt in the euro area, it has moved towards a more neutral policy. So fiscal policy does not subtract any more demand from the economy, but it does not add much either. So this is, underlines what the leaders of the G20 try to express in their conclusion, namely that monetary policy is left too much alone in carrying the burden of sustaining a growth and demand. Monetary policy, indeed, considerably supported the economy. This is composite credit cost indicator. When it goes down, so it means the conditions are considerably more favorable for credit for both the households and non-financial cooperation. So monetary policy, in a sense, is doing what it has to. One can discuss whether they reacted at the right time during the crisis, but I think now monetary policy is doing its best, and now we have to see what fiscal policy can do. Now, on the fiscal policy, if one looks at how fiscal policy in Europe behaved since the beginning of the crisis, and even before, and compared to the what happened on the other side of the Atlantic, then what is the conclusion? I think if you take this, what you can see here is the euro area, that is the red bar, and the US, that is the blue bar. If you are below zero, then it's an expansionary fiscal policy. If you are above zero, it is a restrictive fiscal policy. What you can see here is that if one takes the period 2008 till 2015, here, that's what I have in this graph here, all in all, so you take it as a period, then there is not much difference between US and Europe. If you take the integral part, or the integral of all this, so you sum up all these changes, there is not much difference over the period between the two. What is different, obviously, is the fact that the US has been, US fiscal policy has been more anti-cyclical than the one of Europe. So basically, they expanded much more. You see the blue bar going down at the beginning of the crisis. We did it as well, but much less. And then when growth returned in the US more strongly than in Europe, they moved to fiscal retrenchment, so to a restrictive fiscal policy. Now, let's be clear on this. US fiscal policy has not been driven by, enlightened politicians. The result is better than what we have, but what you get there when they move to retrenchment is, behind that, there is the struggle between the administration and the Congress with the fight on the debt ceiling, the sequester, the shutting down of the government in Washington, and so on and so forth. So it has not been the smooth, optimal social planner there who managed everything in a nice way. Behind that, very dirty politics in the U.S. We'll have to see now what is going to happen with the new administration, because at the end of the year they will have to deal with the debt break again. The Republicans have been staunchly against increasing the debt ceiling for the U.S. debt. Now that was when you had the Democrat in the White House. Now we'll have to see what happens when the Congress and the administration are aligned. What motivated, I think, our retrenchment here, start 2010, 11 and 12, I think was at the time the crisis of the sovereign debt, which for many countries threatened the market access. You know it in this country in particular. Overall, the euro area had to go to move to a more restrictive fiscal policy, in a situation of poor growth, so a pro-cyclical fiscal policy motivated by the need to maintain market access by a number of number of countries. So I think there is the message here that you get, I think there is a way to improve the anti-cyclical stance of fiscal policy in Europe. That's what we, I think, should do looking forward, especially if we want to take out some burden off the shoulders of the ECB. This is the euro area fiscal stance. Again, it's fiscal consolidation when we are below the below zero. You can see here. I think what you get here is I think the key issue here is not so much the swings here. An important point here is what happens in the pre-crisis period. You can see in the pre-crisis period basically not much happens. It is okay, a little bit expansion, a little bit of consolidation, basically nothing happens substantially. But these were the periods where the euro area was growing at a quite robust pace. So it is the period in which one would expect to seize the opportunity to reduce public debt and create the room for maneuver to then use in the moment of, at the moment of the crisis. So I think the key policy mistakes in Europe were not, paradoxically, not so much in the management of the crisis. Yes, maybe there one could have done things somewhat differently. The market forced a certain behavior. The problems were, I think, in the good times here. And as we know, you know politicians, you know policymakers, the big mistakes are made in good times, not in bad times. So this, the not having created the room for maneuver there by decisively lowering the, reducing public debt, I think was the, it was the problem that then came to haunt us during the crisis, where we did not have that safety margin to use fiscal policy in a more proactive manner. Now, if one looks forward, then what you get from the what member states will have to do in order to respect the rules is somewhat a fiscal consolidation looking forward. So I announce already that the package that the Commission will put forward tomorrow will try to, correct somehow this move into a, into a very restrictive, into a pretty restrictive fiscal policy, which is in this here, while still respecting the rules. But obviously, there is a tension here between implementing the stability and growth pact rigorously and achieving something at the central level, which would be more, supportive of growth. We have constraints, obviously, and the constraints are this. We have accumulated during the crisis a lot, a large stock of public debt. So this limits the room for maneuver. We have Ireland also here, actually. So you can see, you can recognize yourself. Here is the, this is the Irish. For most of these countries, where the debt has gone up after 2007-2008, it has not been because of fiscal profligacy or lazy southerners not working and the government stepping in with public spending. It has been, the quintessential case is this country. It has been because of the banks. So basically, there has been the burden and of the debt has been shifted from the banks to the public sector. Whatever the origin, we find ourselves with this quite large stock of debt. So this implies that the room for maneuver that we have in designing something that is more supportive of growth is not enormous. So this has to be taken into account and limits somehow the room for maneuver. Now, okay, I don't want to go into formulas here. This is for the students. You can distribute the slides and then you can do the maths for those who are versed into quantitative issues. Now, when we come to assess the fiscal space, how much fiscal space do we have? I think I know that there is a debate also in this country, fiscal space, do we have it, or not? Now, there are those on the other side of the Atlantic, actually those who, most of them, they were on the wrong side of the election result. Take Krugman, Summers, and others who say, look, okay, we have had a dramatic fall in the interest rate. So this is the good time to borrow for investment in infrastructure. I mean, the public sector can borrow a quasi zero interest rate, so you can do much more investment, public investment than in normal circumstances with much higher interest rates. Okay, those who emphasize this, they only look at this R star here, which is the interest rate. It is true that the interest rate goes down, then the maximum level of the debt that you can sustain increases. So you have more room for maneuver. But that is not the only element in the picture. And the other two elements here is the growth rate. So this is potential growth, it's not cyclical growth in this quarter, right? It's potential growth looking forward. And this is the maximum primary surplus that you can achieve. So the fiscal space on this is given by taking into account the interest rate, taking into account the growth rate, potential growth, and taking into account the primary surplus that you can achieve. Now, looking forward, potential growth, if you do not undertake the structural reforms that I'm going to talk about in a moment, is going to slowly to go down, merely because of demography. So demography getting older, less contributions to the production function of the country via labor, because we get older, I think will lead to a trend decline in the growth rate. And I think there are good reasons to think that the kind of primary surplus that you can generate in a politically sustainable way in the future may also go down. And one of the reasons is what you have also in the debate right now. I think we'll have to spend more in the future to take care of the elderly. So the demography has an impact not only on the growth rate, but also on the spending. Healthcare, pension, in spite of the reforms that have been done, but also investment in human capital, education, etc. I think the pressure for spending more in this, good spending will go up in the future. So the primary surplus that can be sustained, I think, is going to come down looking forward. So of these three elements, I think the R star, which is the interest rate, I think going down increases the fiscal space, but the other two elements, they probably reduce it. So it is not clear that one can come to the conclusion that we have much more fiscal space than we thought about, and now let's go ahead in a spending spree. I think there is here an element of prudence that has to be taken into account. I'm not going to go through this. These are for the students. I'm very proud of these graphs. So if you have some questions on those later, I am delighted to explain it. That's the professorial element comes through here. This articulates basically in a graphical form what I was trying to say before. Conclusion on the fiscal policy side. Basic conclusions is that, yes, we have to use fiscal policy, I think, in a more proactive manner. Second, we have to continue nonetheless to use fiscal policy in a prudent way. Don't count on having an enormously more fiscal space than we thought about. So prudent fiscal policy remains. Some countries have more fiscal space than others, and they should use it. Other countries, especially with continue having high public debt, I think should be moderate in the way they use fiscal policy. What all countries should do is to change the composition of fiscal policy so that spend more in the good spending, those good spending on the public investment side, material and especially immaterial investment, so human capital, technology, technological innovation, etc., which help both from the short-term viewpoint by boosting demand and also from the longer-term viewpoint, by boosting supply. So this is a no-regret policy, though we know that it's very difficult to do. I mean, we have been preaching at the European Commission to the member states to change, to look at the quality of public finances, not only at the quantity, so to reallocate the resources towards high growth spending, and we have failed because member states do not listen. And why so? Essentially because the vested interests behind the bad spending, let's put it like that in inverted commas, are stronger than the vested interest behind the good spending. So it is very difficult to push member states to move the budget towards the good spending away from the less good ones. So this is, the basic conclusions on the fiscal policy side. Now, the third prong, monetary, fiscal, the third one is the structural reforms, and here we go. A question that comes often, you talk about structural reforms in general. What is the what is structural reforms? I think here, structural reforms are those who tackle fundamental bottlenecks for growth. In the first years of the crisis, we focused on competition enhancing aspects, labor market flexibility, resilience, like pension reforms. I think we have to move here to something that I have called here structural reforms 2.0, which looks more at human capital, education, tackling rents, and also taking care of incorporating the income distribution element in that. Now, structural reforms work. Here are a number of simulations that you have that we have done of, moving to best practices in the EU. By the way, you have also Ireland here. You can look at the slides afterwards. So, in terms of growth and employment, I think they can work. There are two views on structural reforms. How do we promote structural reforms? When should structural reforms be done? And the two views in the economics debate, but you see it also in the Eurogroup when we talk to the ministers, is a more Keynesian view and a more, moral hazard view. And they lead to completely different prescriptions. So the Keynesian view is the following. Structural reforms may have, in the short term, an adverse effect. You liberalize labor market, I think there is pressure downwards on wages, I think more layoffs because you make it more flexible. So in the short term, you have costs in many of the structural reforms, not all. So Keynesian view says, do reforms when you are in good times because the cake is widening. So you have a better chance if one loses a job in one sector, can find it in another one or from moving from one enterprise to another. And the Keynesian view also says, use fiscal policy in order to compensate the losers. So more fiscal leeway, to help those who have, who suffer in the short term from structural reforms. So this is the Keynesian view. Then you have the moral hazard view, and it says that, no, politicians operate in a different way. They do structural reforms, which imply, difficult choices, only when they have no other choice. So this is the TINA, There is no alternative. It's only when they feel that they have shoulder against the wall that they find the courage to make structural reforms. So they say, don't use monetary policy and fiscal policy in order to ease the structural reforms because, they will do even less. So these are two completely different views. One sees fiscal policy done and structural reforms done in good times, the Keynesian one, and the other sees fiscal structural reforms done mainly in bad times. Who wins? Experience of the crisis leads to the conclusion that the moral hazard view wins, but with a but. We have seen during the crisis that countries being more in trouble, they have done more reforms than countries not in trouble. Mm? So this is one a piece of evidence. The but is the fact that in many instances, these reforms being done under duress, they are not fully owned by the system. So when the situation improves, they are reversed. So this is the enlightened politicians would take the Keynesian view. Let's say, okay, let's use fiscal policy in order to ease the and to make difficult choices. But this is the evidence that we have. Now, I finished with this one, which is the sexy part of the presentation. Mr. Juncker, when he was president of the Eurogroup before becoming president of the Commission, said something which has become famous, and he said, talking about social reforms, we all know what we need to do, we do not know how to be re-elected after we have done it. Hmm? This is Juncker's curse. Hmm? Now, okay. Juncker is my boss, so he's president of the Commission now, so he's always right. But he said this before becoming president of the Commission, so he was not my boss at the time. So I can contest this. And as an empirical economist, I have, some colleagues, I have tested whether he was right in this statement, that governments carrying out structural reforms actually, you know, they basically, you know, lose elections after they have done that. And the evidence is not clear-cut. So you have many cases of governments actually having undergone courageous structural reforms and having been re-elected afterwards. So in this paper, we looked at what are the determinants for being re-elected or not after you have done structural reforms. And what we found is that, and this was with data before the crisis, but we have replicated that after the crisis, and the message is basically the same. Financial markets functioning and the functioning of welfare systems are key in the probability of being re-elected after you have done structural reforms. It is not difficult to understand why. Well-functioning financial markets, what do they do? They help to reallocate resources from one sector to another, and they help also to bring forward to the present the benefits of structural reforms. So if you have well-functioning financial markets, then the likelihood that you get quicker response to the structural reform program, I think, is higher. That's why countries, governments having done reforms in countries with well-functioning financial markets, I think they have a higher probability of being re-elected. Second point is the functioning of the welfare state, tax and benefit system I talked about before. There also, if you have welfare system functioning well, they can reduce the cost for the losers of the structural reforms in the first place. So what you get there is that you have the social impact of structural reforms is lower for these countries. So these two elements here are particularly important in the prospect of being or not re-elected. So in convincing the politicians that they can do structural reforms. And also, what does it mean in practice here? It means that we have to continue to restore good health in financial markets. At the EU level, a euro area level, it means proceeding steadfastly to complete banking union and to move forward on capital markets union. And in welfare system is to have structural reforms and also looking at the functional tax and benefit systems, which you know, which take care of the losers. And indeed, in the past years, the generosity of the welfare systems have been decreased, and this is in part one of the reasons why there has been the hardship. Of the reforms. I think I had another couple of things, but this is the conclusion. Okay, the conclusion, you can read it yourself. I have this has been a plea for the G20 to implement what the leaders have agreed upon. So the the three-pronged strategy in European source. I think we, if you move to more fiscal, more proactive fiscal policies. Why not, throwing away the rules that we have? I think this will also help in strengthening demand domestically, so increase, better manage global imbalances, because we have now, Euro area has a large current account surplus, so we have less, more supportive fiscal policy. Also, we reduce the pressure on monetary policy, so it is more likely that the ECB more quickly return to orthodoxy, moving away from negative rates, which we know are, heavy consequences on the banking system. Can we achieve everything at the national level through better coordination? My plea here would be that to consider also an investment and euro area fiscal capacity to supplement what can be done at the national level. It is not there. This is something I think we are going to work on in view of the white paper that the Commission will put forward in view of the next March, which is the Leaders' Summit in Rome for the 60th anniversary of the Union. Thank you very much.